So it's funny, actually, because I just realized looking up at your IMDb page, which is always very important, that I'm actually older than you.
Well, if you are, not by much.
By a year.
Why do you act so surprised?
Because you seem like such an adult.
No, it's because I look so old. You can.
No, it's not that at all. There's an adult. There's a weight to you that I think has always been apparent.
Oh.
In your work.
All right, I'll take that as a compliment.
Has it always been that way? Were you always playing older than you were when you were 22?
Yes, always. I've always played older. And just when I think, oh, I'm starting to catch up to my age, I look in the mirror and I go, no, I'm not.
You'll never quite catch up.
Yeah, I'll never quite get there.
What do you consume? It's a weird question, I know, to start with, but what is it that makes, I mean, you're laughing, which is nice. What makes you laugh? What is funny to you? Because it seems like in your work, it's always, the writing is more funny than the performances, but you seem to get cast in very serious roles.
Ah, interesting. I don't know. You know, some of that is about, you know, Alex Gonza, who created Homeland, saw Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf. And he said, you have a kind of gravity I need for this character that I want to put in our show. And so I wound up joining Homeland for a couple of years. And so everybody saw me play the asshole in the suit for a couple of years.
Mm-hmm.
And so they assume that's what you are or that's what you do. And so you find yourself weighing different options of things you might do, but they're all variations on a theme. They're all assholes in a suit. Whereas, mm-hmm. On stage in Chicago, I've played A to Z. But for a while, anyway, on camera, I've been the asshole in the suit. And again, even in Christine, which is a beautiful script, and there's a lot of nuance, and there's more to the guy than just an asshole in a suit. But there's, again, variation on a theme, right? Mm-hmm. He's the boss. And he's the disgruntled boss. He's put out with his... So some of it is just about the way people perceive you for a while until you're able to break out of that for a little bit. Like, I'll give you a good example. Mike Shannon, who we've talked about, who's done a lot of work with me. I mean, people don't recognize just how funny Mike is.
He's a funny guy.
Very, very funny guy. But they think of him as intense, murderous, violent, pent up, whatever that stuff is. I just think of him as... very funny, goofy Mike Shannon.
Yes.
It's the way you see people for a while. But eventually people come around and they recognize, oh, Mike Shannon's really funny. So he starts to get a chance to do some funnier stuff.
We got to play the Christmas Fairy or whatever in that the Night Before, I think it was called.
Yeah.
And it was very, very funny.
Yeah, he's a funny guy.
But he is a very funny guy.
Yeah.
And he is a little menacing and scary and at the same time. I mean, there's like an intimidating energy. Even when he's being funny.
Yeah. Yes, well, maybe one of the things that makes him funny, but I don't know. I've known him for so long that I don't see the intimidating part so much.
So do you make choices as to which hat you're going to wear for periods of time? I mean, you seem to be in an acting mode right now for the last 2 years, couple years. You were writing, you know, you were known for your Pulitzer Prize winning play. A few years before that was kind of the star attraction with you. And Killer Joe and other shows before that. I mean, do you make those choices as you go? Does it kind of just come as things come?
It comes as things come. I suppose the only real conscious choice I made was that I decided to stop acting in so many plays.
Mm.
I've acted in two or three plays a year for 30 years, and it's, I guess I never... realize just how time-consuming it is. It takes a lot of time to act in a play. And so I did Virginia Woolf, and I said, well, I'm exhausted from doing this. I'm not going to act on stage for a while. I have done another play since then. I did Will Eno's The Realistic Joneses on Broadway, but it was kind of easy comparatively. It was 90 minutes long. I didn't have a lot of lines. Comedy, mm-hmm. it was fun to do. So I did that because they were friends of mine, Will Eno and Sam Gold. They're buddies of mine. So I did that. But for the most part, I've just not done plays. And it's opened up a lot of my schedule. So you can shoot one of these movies, and especially at this level, these independent films, they shoot in 3 or 4 weeks. 3 or 4 weeks doesn't even get you out of rehearsals for a play. You're still rehearsing a play after 3 or 4 weeks. So the idea that I could step in and do this thing and then step out of it, a couple of these movies I've shot in much less time than that, just a few days. That's really appealing to me. And it means I can. There's even more time for writing. So, you know, I had a new play at Steppenwolf back in March. I have a new play at Steppenwolf coming up this coming spring. So I continue to write plenty.
Are you any one thing first, or
no?
Are you just everything?
I'm everything.
I mean, is there pleasure? Is it a different set of muscles? Does it all feel like somehow connected to the creativity that you put on stage when you act versus when you're writing?
I said in another interview recently, I said, well, it's all storytelling, and the interviewer got mad at me. So, well, that's a little easy, isn't it? I suppose it is a little easy, but it does all feel connected to just the best way to tell a story. You know, as an actor, my only responsibility is to the guy I'm playing. I just have to know my thing, my job, my mission. As a writer, I'm responsible for everything everybody says. So the responsibilities are very different. But they still rely on a lot of the same skills of observation, empathy, mimicry, presence.
Is writing more personal?
Well, my immediate reaction to that is yes, though acting's pretty personal because it's just me, right? It's all coming out of me. But, you know, the writing is more personally revealing. It reveals more of who I am. And I have to say that there's probably nothing more gratifying than a new play going up, being realized. That's probably ultimately the most gratifying of all the things I do.
So I gather August had personal connections for you, specific personal connections
sure.
for you.
Yeah.
But I assume more so than something like Killer Joe or the new shows, or are they, we just don't know as much about you?
Well, maybe August was more directly autobiographical than those other pieces. I would always tell people when we would rehearse the show, work on the show, I would say, it's based on a true story. It's not really true. These characters are amalgams. They're not, and yet then we would sit there in rehearsal and I would say, that really happened. That really happened. Yeah, she really said that. Yep, that happened. I was just go through it and say, yeah, all that is recognizable to me. Mm-hmm. So I think August is perhaps more revealing than some of the other things. But they're all, I've come to be aware that all the characters are me. All the characters in something I write, they're all me. They're all some facet of me mm-hmm. coming out. Me putting on different hats or just different aspects of my personality. I think if you're any good at that job, the job of dramatist, you're able to explore those different facets of your personality that are both the way you'd most like to see yourself as well as the truth of the matter, you know, who you really are at your best and at your worst.
Is there a consistent thing that clicks when you decide to actually start working on something new?
I'm so intuitive in terms of that, in terms of the thing I'm going to work on. It's always been very intuitive for me. And I've really come to trust that intuition. I'm very rarely wrong about the thing I want to do. Mm-hmm. It's rare that I come away from something saying, I just never should have gotten involved in that. I never should have written that. I never should have appeared in that.
So even with acting parts and whatever, it's you've had that same connective.
Yeah.
Huh.
Somebody asked me just last night, another guy who's acting and writing out here in LA, and he asked me just last night, he said, well, haven't you ever regretted turning down some of the things you've turned down? Not one. Not even a little bit. Even wildly successful things. Things that people won awards for that I've turned down. Mm. And I have no regret. Zero regret.
Because you believe in... I mean, is it intellectual at all? Or is it just because you just... It's a gut.
It's just... I know I know the stuff I want to work on. I know the stuff I want to work on, and I know the stuff I don't.
And the prizes are lovely, but not really your priority.
They're not my priority. No. They're great. No, it's great. You kidding? They're great. But no, you can't choose work based on that.
And do you have a less, is it less weighty, I guess, to take on a movie role where you're going to go work for a week or a few days or 2 weeks or whatever versus, I mean, in terms of the choice being not disappointing or not anything else, is it kind of like, well, I did it, I got what I got out of it, and life moves on?
Even, well, yeah. I mean, for one thing, because you get to step in and out of them so quickly. But yeah, even then, I feel like I just want to work on the good stuff. I just want to work on smart material with passionate filmmakers. You know, I've made quite a few of these things in the last couple of years, and most of them have been below a certain budget level. I don't really know the numbers, but they've been, judging from the catering, they've been pretty down and dirty.
Yeah.
We, on Christine, oh my God, we got to the point where we would go out for lunch and we would say, what's for lunch? Meat in hot water. Just like, we couldn't tell what the meat was, but it was soaking in hot water.
Ooh.
That was lunch.
You're kind of hoping for Stouffer's lasagna at that point. Yeah.
So they've all been below a certain level budget-wise, but they've all been with really passionate filmmakers, passionate crews. No money, no frills, but people who are really good at their jobs, getting their jobs done. I've loved it.
And what do you take from the director? I mean, somebody like Antonio has an intense but relatively brief career at this point, still kind of starting up the machinery. Do you take anything away from your directors as a regular thing?
Well, Antonio's very accomplished, and he's very skilled, and he's very confident. He knows exactly what he's doing, and he knows exactly what he wants. As a director, you just have to worry about a lot of stuff I don't care about.
Mm.
You have to worry about lights and, you know, the color of the wallpaper. And I just don't care about that stuff. I care about character and story and language. I mean, that's the stuff, that's where all my focus is. And again, that's one of the ways that the writing and the acting intersect. That's what my level of interest is.
But do you care how you're directed? I mean, is that a big thing
for
you? Sure.
Well, you know, Antonio's... he's really good. I mean, all these people have been really good. You know, the language in film is different than the language in the theater. In the theater, we get into a lot of psychological realism, and we go over, you know, every line of dialogue. By the time we get a show up, we've gone over every line. Where does this line come from? The study in film is a little different.
Mm-hmm.
So the language between an actor and a director in film is a little different. And I've had to adjust to that a little bit. I've had to get accustomed to that. I'm expected, I think, in film or TV to bring a larger toolkit with me. Not necessarily anticipating that the director is going to have a lot to say to me, which is fine if that's the case. But Antonio and I had a great rapport on the set of Christine. And again, it comes back to storytelling. What is this moment? What are we trying to accomplish with this scene? Are the lines helping us accomplish that with the scene? Is there a way I can deliver this line that it helps accomplish it with the scene? Rebecca's talked about a kind of secret language they had where he almost through gesture would show her whether she was internalizing in the right way, and that he was seeing it through the camera, or that he needed more, he needed less. They were modulating that almost non-verbally.
Yeah. She talked about him pointing to his own stomach.
Yeah, that doesn't happen in the theater. That's a very different kind of discourse.
It'd be hard from the 10th row to
scream
up, my tummy. So when you, working for Jim Sheamus, which you've got an enormous acclaim for this relatively small role in this movie, did you know you were going into a scene-stealing situation where you were going to be get this kind of attention for this relatively small role?
No, I didn't. I mean, I knew it was a... You never know what these things are going to amount to, you know? You read the script, you know there's not a lot of money involved. You know, it's a pretty literate thing, period piece, based on a Philip Roth book. I knew James Shamus. I took the part before I had read the screenplay. I just knew that James Shamus had written the screenplay, that he was directing, that it was based on a Philip Roth book. I said, I'm in. Those are the people I want to work with. I don't care what it is. And then I read it, and we had to start work on it very soon. And I was like, I got a hell of a lot of lines to learn here. That, for me, it became a question of memorization, first and foremost. I just got to learn all these damn lines if we're going to get through this scene. And I wasn't surprised that, again, at that budget level, we shot that in one day. We shot that 15 minutes in one day, a grueling day, a very difficult day, just in terms of concentration. I mean, it's not breaking rocks in the hot sun, but just, you know, it took a lot of concentration to get through that day. It was exhausting for me and for Logan, but no, I had no idea it was going to have the impact it did. You know, I saw it for the first time at Sundance, completed. Christine, Indignation, and Wiener Dog were all at Sundance, and I had not seen any of them, so I got to see them all with full audiences for the first time. It was really the only good part about Sundance. I was getting to see them with, you know, full audiences enjoying those films. Mm-hmm. And so, yeah, to see that scene in Indignation for the first time with an audience was great. It was fun.
And why did you end up signing up with Todd? Is that another artist out there that you just, I think I'll try to work with him?
Todd Solondz is interested in you for his next, I'm in. Again, I didn't read the script. It was Todd Solondz. I want to work with Todd Solondz. I'm in. I don't care what it is. It turned out it was this great little vignette at the beginning of the film, working with Todd, and he's every bit the artist that I believed him to be. Visually, on the page, in every way. Todd's the real deal.
Is it the spirit of Steppenwolf, or did you, as one of the builders of Steppenwolf, create the spirit of Steppenwolf, and therefore it's in your image in a way, and all of your compatriots there, that this kind of like artists group mentality?
I don't know. That's a good question. You know, I'm actually working with Laurie Metcalf right now. We're playing husband and wife. We've never worked together before. Huh. Been members of the same theater company for all these years, and we've never actually done anything together before. So there's an understanding as soon as we get on the set together that, oh, we come from the same background. We speak the same language. I know who you are. You know who I am. And yeah, wanting to surround yourself with like-minded people, people who are, you know, not a lot of bullshit. Christine was about the best time I've ever had working on camera because of the ensemble nature of the work we were doing in that studio. All those actors who gathered for that, we all understood the mission of the piece. We understood our job within that mission. I had just done that play I said I went back to Broadway to do was The Realistic Joneses, and Michael C. Hall was in it. I think that's the way I wound up in Christine. I think they were interested in using Michael in the movie, and so they came to see the play, Antonio and Craig, and they saw me and said, oh, maybe we should ask Tracy to do this other part. Mm-hmm. So I think that's how I wound up in it. So there we were in Savannah, me, Michael C. Hall, Maria Dizia, who's married to Will Eno, who wrote The Realistic Joneses, Rebecca, Kim Shaw, Tim Simons, etc. Some other people who were gathered together as a collective. We shot most of that movie in that studio. I mean, Rebecca had a different job than the rest of us. And we had a great ensemble spirit there, a real sense of passing the ball back and forth. We were also having a great time. I'm a big proponent of an environment that is fun and relaxed and funny. I'm always the one cracking jokes and stuff. I just think people do their best work in that kind of environment. I mean, we knew Rebecca would be the first to tell you she's not a method actress, and she could sit and joke with us when she was off camera. But at the same time, on the harder days for her, we knew to keep our distance from her or give her the room that she needed to do her stuff. But there was just a great ensemble spirit on that set.
I kind of feel like that's the phenomenon of the last 10 years or so of filmmaking, I guess, in the era of smaller cameras and everything else, or digital cameras, that somehow there seems to be, I mean, it's growing out of Chicago, it's growing out of Austin, it's growing out of Seattle, where there's, and out of New York with the guys from the Compost Group.
Yeah.
There seems to be this sense of community that I don't remember being there in, 2000, where everything was just kind of like drive everything to Hollywood, try to get to Hollywood, try to get a movie made. It just seems like a different universe.
Having not worked a lot in 2000 as an actor, I don't have a lot to compare it to, but I hope you're right about that. Certainly the things I've done have had that spirit about them, and I've really, really enjoyed it. Even a movie like Wiener Dog, where we're in vignettes, and so we didn't see each other a lot of the time while we were making the movie, but once we gathered together in Sundance to do it, there was a recognition that we as an ensemble had created this. Because there's different ways to create ensemble. It's not just everybody in a room at the same time. There are different ways of passing the ball. Mm-hmm. And we all felt, when we got together for Wiener Dog, that, again, we were all on the same page of that movie. We all went out there with the idea of, helping Todd to realize his very particular idiosyncratic vision. And everybody signed up for that. I met Greta for the first time that night at the Sundance premiere, and this movie I'm doing with Lori right now, Greta's writer-director. So I think there is a sense of camaraderie and ensemble among some of these young filmmakers. I think it's really cool.
And is that another case where you kind of like, it's Greta, let's go play?
Pretty much. I mean, Scott Rudin's producing, he'd sent me the script, and I was so impressed with her script. Just really beautiful screenplay, a coming-of-age story that Greta's written about growing up in Sacramento. And I was just so impressed with it and liked her so much. Yeah, I'm in.
Is there something odd about having your work, your theater work, made, once it's made into a movie, and you've had a few of them now, that it's kind of like, is it the end of, does it feel like the end of something? Or like there's now a monument to it? So it doesn't live on quite the same way?
Yeah, it just feels like another version. I mean, I don't... As the years go on, the plays sort of revert back to just being a play in the best sense of that.
Mm-hmm.
Streetcar, for instance, which is a brilliant play and a great film in its own right, they're very different from each other. Now, you can do the play Streetcar Named Desire again. You can do it without all the associations of Brando and Kazan and beautiful cinematography. You can just do the play for people. In some ways, the plays start to return themselves. I felt that was kind of the job with when I did Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf. The barnacles that start to get attached to a project like that, sometimes because of the movie. I think the movie of Who's Afraid of Virginia Woolf is a great horror film. It doesn't have a lot to do with the play. It's very different experience than the play. And so to do the play again and just return it to its theatrical roots. So I guess in answer to your question, I like all three of those films that they made, but they're just separate. They're just separate from my plays.
I guess Bug feels the most like such a different experience inherently, seeing that in the theater versus seeing it in film. There's something about the literal nature of film that
and
takes
yet,
it in a very different place.
It probably hews most closely to the play. It probably actually they're probably closer to each other, just in terms of what happens in the language. Probably the film version of Bug is closest to the play than either Killer Joe or August.
And you've talked about August not being a disappointment to you, as it were, as it was for a number of people. But that it seems like you've kind of at peace with it existing as it exists and finding an audience, and your play will go on.
Yeah, the play goes on. The movie, you can watch it or not. Play goes on.
And when that play was happening, how is it, I mean, with all the attention, all the awards, everything else that was going on Broadway, really starting in Chicago, but is that very head spinning? Does it put you?
Oh, that was head spinning. That was head spinning. For a guy who can act cool about a lot of this stuff. That was a head spinner. August was a head spinner. I mean, we thought we had a good play. We thought people were going to pay attention to it. We knew it was a big piece. Nobody could have anticipated the response to that thing in the theater. I mean, the response was overwhelming. That, and not only in Chicago, but in New York, and then London, and then Sydney, the response was overwhelming to that thing. I've never really experienced anything like it in the theater before. I don't know that I'll have that experience again.
It's pretty rare. I mean, yeah, we see it with Hamilton, and we saw it with the producers, yeah, but...
Pretty rare.
For a straight play, too. It's very, very rare.
Yeah.
Did it make sense to you in any way? Did it connect anything that was clear?
I mean, it started to reveal itself to me. I mean, one of the first things we saw, one of the very first previews we ever did, we saw the audience, and this was a audience at Steppenwolf, so largely middle-class audience, theater-savvy people in Chicago, our audience that we've seen many, many times, talking back to the stage, talking to each other, talking to strangers in the audience. Do you believe this? Do you believe what you're seeing? You know, we saw that kind of crosstalk, and we realized we've tapped into, there's something universal about this, speaking to people who, as they're watching this. There's something about it that people recognize, and it seems to cut across socioeconomic strata. It seems to really have an impact, because it had the same impact in New York, London, Sydney, and has continued to around the world. So once, that's very gratifying as a writer. You write something that's specific to you, and then you find out, but it speaks to everybody. That's a great thing.
I know, I paid to see it 3 times.
Oh, that's great.
I actually think I saw it in previews on Broadway, and then I went back again, and I took my wife, because it was a remarkable experience.
We would literally see people getting their cell phones out as they're walking up the aisle during one of the intermissions, calling people saying, you have to see this. And we're like, yeah, that's a good thing, what we're seeing right there. That's exciting.
Well, I remember going, and it was like, it's 3 hours long plus. Yeah. And I'm like, okay, fingers crossed.
Right.
And then you want more of it somehow at the end. It's an amazing experience.
Yeah.
So your life has kind of worked out, it seems like, perfectly.
Well, I'm very grateful. I'm very happy for where I am right now. I mean, it's all been very incremental. I never made any money until August, until I was 42. I mean, Killer Joe and Bug, Man from Nebraska, they were successful pieces, but on a cultish small theater level, you know, so it's not like they ever paid me a lot of money. I spent 4 years out here in L.A. From 97 to 2001, and I did some stuff. I did a Seinfeld, I did a Home Improvement, you know, I did some guest spots.
Enriching experiences.
Yeah, they weren't really. I mean, they were great. It was thrilled when I got those jobs. Yeah. But when I left and went back to Chicago, I happily took a vow of poverty to go do theater in Chicago, which has never paid any money. Mm. And so I never really made any money at this. And I was all right. I wasn't exactly desperate. But it's just been incremental successes, one step up, you know, from year to year to year, and it's great. I'm very grateful. I know a lot of really, really talented people who are not enjoying the work I have right now. So I feel very grateful.
We get to play to all the fields. I mean, that's kind of seems like the dream thing is you get to, you know, do the work you want to do, and not only one, you're not only successful in one job, you're successful in 3 different jobs.
Yeah, and I've always done them separately. There's never been a lot of crossover between the writing and the acting. I don't write things for me to act in. I don't have any interest in doing that. I don't think I'd do it as well. I think I'd be very self-conscious. I'm not Orson Welles. I don't think many people are Orson Welles. I don't think Orson Welles is walking through the door anytime soon. I think those are special cases. So there's not been a lot of crossover. There's been forward movement with one and then a little forward movement with the other. Very little crossover, but...
It's kind of hard to imagine. I would imagine that for theater, that would be much harder than if you wrote a screenplay, for instance. I mean, I would think that because the intimacy and the significance of the playwright in theater compared to a film writer, It's a very different animal.
It is very different.
Yeah.
I mean, Edward Albee, who just passed away, used to talk about that. I mean, you know, Edward never made the leap to Hollywood. He didn't want to. He was glad he was a playwright. That's what he wanted to be, and that's where he found his, not only his voice, but his real significance as a writer was as a playwright. It's a smaller field, but you know, Edward also always used to talk about how the playwright is the boss, mm-hmm. you know, and for him that was really important. It's nice. It's less important for me because I have great collaborators at Steppenwolf, and I listen to them. I don't just throw my Pulitzer around and say, do it my way. I mean, they still call me on my bullshit and say, no, that's a terrible idea. We have to do this instead. And I listen to them when they say that. So it's a really good situation.
That must be like the great, because you see movie stars happen, whatever, and you know, they're 5 years into their stardom and they only really trust the people they came up with.
Right.
And it seems like you have a whole family of people at Steppenwolf, besides your own family or whoever is in your life that way, that you can trust that way, artistically, and count on.
Yeah, I do. Because I've seen the effect of the other, when somebody's gotten so big that nobody can possibly question their choices. And everybody makes bad choices. Everybody throws some shitty paint on the canvas and needs to be... Everybody.
Well, you need to, right? To throw good paint, you need that for a shitty paint.
That's right. But if there's not somebody there to edit, to help you, you know, even the greatest novelists of our time had editors behind the scenes, you know, helping them to shape that material. So, you always, unless you're Picasso or you're Orson Welles, and you're not, you need somebody else.
Well, they had their things, too. I mean, sure. I don't know about Picasso exactly, but Orson Welles certainly, you know, there were other voices in his head.
Right.
Other people around. Talk to Houseman or something and see what they have to say about it. So is there anything you haven't done that you're aching to do? Are you an acher?
That's a good question. I don't know that there is. I don't know that there is. I don't know that there is. Oh my God, that may actually just send me into a real existential spiral that I don't have anything I'm aching to do. I don't know that there is. I think I'm doing it. I think I'm doing the things I've ached to do.
And do you still consume material? I mean, are you a regular theater goer?
Oh,
are you a regular
hell
film goer?
Yes. Oh yeah, I see, you know, you can't keep up.
Yeah.
Especially with TV these days, forget it. There's no keeping up.
Yeah.
I have gotten to the point where people say, you have to watch this. No, I don't. No, I don't. Because then I'll watch it and I'll say, I really didn't have to watch that. Or I really could have watched a few of those and gotten the flavor and stopped. And I've gotten better about that. Yeah, I watched a few of those. I know what that show, I think I got the sense of that.
Yeah.
But yeah, no, I still consume a lot. I still read a lot of books, see a lot of movies, and see a lot of plays,
And does consuming bring you the joy that it brought you when you were younger?
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I'm happier when I see good stuff than when I see bad stuff. But, you know, Carrie and I were just in Melbourne. She was shooting season 3 of The Leftovers there, and we happened to be there while the Melbourne Film Festival was going on. Mm-hmm. I bought us passes. We just became festival goers for a couple of weeks. She had a lot of time off from the show, and we saw about 15 movies in a couple of weeks. It was great. It turned out I was in a couple of them, and they learned that I was in. The people realized, oh, you're there, and you're seeing these movies, and so will you do some press for us? And I said, I wound up doing that, working a little bit, but we just went to see really bizarro, off-the-wall stuff. Huh. I had a great time. I saw great stuff.
Did you know that those films were, I mean, was that like the first time you were seeing these films, and you decided to go?
Yeah, just went through the catalog, just like a festival goer, you know, went through the catalog. Oh, that looks interesting.
I'm going to go see that Tracy Letts movie.
Yeah.
I bet he's great. I'd marry him if I knew him. He's the best guy ever.
it was a lot of fun. It was also a good way to learn the city, get around on the tram and go to the different venues. And
Melbourne's a good city.
Oh, it's great.
Yeah.
We really enjoyed it.
So... You're hopeful, it sounds like, overall. I mean, it sounds like you're... I mean, there are a lot of people talking about the end of drama and film and the, you know, troubles, hard to get this made, hard to get that made. It sounds like you kind of have a... just a hopeful, positive sense of where we are artistically in the world, that there's still that opportunity.
There are always going to be storytellers, and always there's going to be a need for stories, and there's always going to be a way to get those stories out in the world one way or another. Always. That's not going anywhere. Now, you know, there will always be a problem with that. There will always be, you know, there will always be issues of quality, you know, but the way the audience, I mean, the population is so big now, you not everything has to have a... Let me tell you a story. So, people were... I'll tell you a good story.
Okay.
So we were making Wiener Dog, and Julie Delpy was giving Todd a hard time at lunch about a... about a Muhammad joke he had in the movie. And she was trying to scare him, convincing him that terrorists were going to come after him because of his Muhammad joke. And it was working. He was starting to get scared. And he turned to me and he said, "What do you think about this?" And I said, "I think it's a ridiculous conversation." And he said, "Why?" And I said, "Because nobody's going to see this movie." You know? And Todd, he didn't blink an eye. He was just like, "The money people are over there. They don't know that." I guess what I'm saying is there's an audience for everything. Mm-hmm. You know, I don't go see... I go to see Wiener Dog at the movie theater. Mm-hmm. I don't go to see Captain America. They're not making Captain America for me.
Mm-hmm.
Right? They're making it for a different audience. So there's an audience for everything out. Clearly, there's a lot of people in the world who want to see the new Captain America movie. It's easy not to see stuff.
Yeah.
It's easy not to go see Captain America if that's not your cup of tea.
Yeah, but there's still stuff for you to see.
Yeah, there's plenty of stuff to see.
That's the thing that's so... I mean, I agree with you completely, but it's kind of always fascinating when people start kind of whining about... to me, there's more stuff now to see than ever, and more good stuff. We have more access to more things, including the catalogs going back and everything else, than we've ever had before in our lives.
How many movies do we make a year in this country? 500? 400, 500? How many movies can you see, for
exactly.
God's sake? Bye.
She's going to see a movie right now. But yeah, I mean, you can like go through the Criterion catalog at home, you know, at home, yeah, on your television, big TV. You can, yeah, watch a movie. You can
see. Can't possibly catch up with all the things,
yeah,
you need to see.
With all just the good stuff.
Yeah.
Forget all the shitty stuff. There's plenty,
yeah,
of that too.
Yeah.
Well, I'm glad you're still making good stuff.
Thanks.
Thank you so much for your time. I
Thanks a lot.
It.
Appreciate it.
And say hello to your wife.
I will.
Tell her she's brilliant.
I'll tell her you're tracking her down.